Today, we are going to share the preliminary results of the digital projects that we have been working on, together with our volunteers at Jarrow Hall Anglo-Saxon Farm, Village and Bede Museum in Tyne and Wear, UK, reopened by Groundworks South and North Tyneside in 2016 after the closure of the previous Bede's World Museum. I will now introduce our museum and the wider context of this research. My colleague Gianluca Foschi from the McCord Centre for Landscape at Newcastle University and Rebecca Romeo-Pitone from Apex Acoustics will then talk about the more technical aspects of this work. Jirwi, the demonstrative Anglo-Saxon farm conceived as part of the Bede's World Museum, was constructed in the early 90s as an interpretation of a 700 AD agricultural landscape to showcase elements of farming and secular life in Bede's time. Timber buildings were constructed based on Anglo-Saxon sites found in ancient Northumbria. These were Building A at Thirlings, a few kilometres to the northeast of Yeavering, a Grubenhaus found at New Bewick in the same area, and Building 8 from the monastic site of Hartlepool. A demonstrative, non-experimental reinterpretation of the Grandstand found at Yeavering was also constructed. After almost 30 years since their construction, these buildings are now in need of repairs. This seemed to be the perfect project for our team of enthusiastic volunteers. A dedicated group was set up to actively participate to the redevelopment of Jirwi, and our volunteers were involved since the very beginning in the initial assessment of the buildings. The first step was to collect all relevant data available on the experimental projects carried out previously, but in absence of a former experimental archive, the research had to be based only on a very few general papers. It appeared clear that, before any further redevelopment project could be designed, the buildings had to be accurately documented. To this end, a series of technological solutions were adopted, facilitating the visual recording of these structures and their condition. A survey of each building was carried out to preliminarily assess its general conditions and highlight matters of concern to be submitted to the surveyors for a professional structural assessment. The plan of the archaeological context and its graphic simplification were utilised to produce a hand-drawn map report, where each post and wall was numbered or named. This preliminary report was converted in a rather schematic Excel sheet. To facilitate future data collection on the buildings and the production of more accurate reports, as well as to make sure that the reconstructed buildings were documented appropriately, the museum reached out for help, establishing a fertile collaboration with the McCord Centre for Landscape at Newcastle University, with the aim of carrying out a 3D survey of the experimental buildings. That would have been just the beginning of a wider project which now involves our volunteers, Newcastle University, Apex Acoustics, with other stakeholders likely to join in the near future.
The survey activities carried out at Jirwi by Newcastle University's McCord Centre for Landscape in collaboration with Jarrow Hall are based on 3D laser scanning. This technique allows for obtaining extremely detailed and accurate 3D models of structures, objects and landscape features. Even large buildings can be surveyed with a laser scanner, spending only a few days on site, while the processing of the data, which is often particularly complex and time-consuming, can be completed remotely. The volunteers at Jarrow Hall were engaged by Newcastle University and trained on 3D laser scanning during the fieldwork. Between 2020 and 2021, three different three-dimensional surveys and one acoustic test were completed at Jarrow in collaboration with Apex Acoustics. The data are being used for a new analysis of the archaeological experiments at Jarrow Hall addressing the complex interaction between multisensoriality, material culture and society. In this paper we will concentrate on the archaeoacoustics of Building A from Thirlings and of the Grandstand from Yeavering. A fundamental step in tackling this complex topic was the design of 3D audiovisual models based on the data gathered at Jarrow Hall and simulating as accurately as possible the acoustics of the surveyed experimental buildings. The point cloud recorded by the laser scanner was automatically transformed into a polygonal mesh using the Pharosyn software. This mesh was manually refined in AutoCAD using the point cloud itself to obtain a model of the building as it was during the acoustic test. Finally, the ODEON auditorium software allowed for room acoustic simulation based on this model and calibrated according to the real sound parameters from the acoustic test. At this point, How different materials and geometries affect the acoustics of the experimental building can be explored by modifying the obtained digital model without affecting the structures on site. The peculiarity of this approach is the particularly preeminent role accorded to 3D laser scanning for the design of digital models to be run in ODEON auditorium. The use of a mesh automatically created from the point cloud implies more time-consuming processing in ODEON, but guarantees that the differences between the simulated and the real acoustic parameters derive from the sound absorption properties assigned to the digital model, and not from inaccuracies in the geometry. Once the sound parameters are adjusted, the 3D model can be modified, and this constitutes an exceptional opportunity to address uncertainty. Visual and sound properties can be investigated considering different materials and architectural solutions, and all the arbitrary choices that could not be avoided during the experimental reconstructions on site can be compared to any other possible alternatives. Also, the models can be transformed into high definition and interactive visual content to be integrated with the oral materials produced in ODEON to offer a range of potential multisensory experiences instead of univocal reconstructions. The digital models of the experimental buildings provide the opportunity to acquire new data on the role that sound could have played in past societies. This role is the object of archaeoacoustics, a well-established field of studies investigating all aspects of the interactions between past human activities and sound. This field is connected to landscape archaeology, historical architecture, and the archaeology of sound-producing devices, and is increasingly related to cognitive studies and psychoacoustics. Past conceptions of music are other aspects that should be carefully considered in archaeoacoustics. The famous passage about Cædmon in Bede's Historia demonstrates that music could be referred directly to divine revelations. This is consistent with the musical conceptions of many early medieval contexts outside Britain, often characterized by distinctions between licit and illicit types of music. In these cases, music could have been a wide notion, also extended to non-oral concepts connected to cosmic order, considered particularly powerful and sometimes even interlaced to hegemonic narratives.
The term soundscape was popularized by Canadian composer Amory Schaeffer in the late 70s. Almost 50 years after the publication of his book, The Soundscape, Our Sonic Environment and the Tuning of the World, soundscape has become a field of research in its own right. It is one of the most exciting multidisciplinary crossroads of our time, as it involves an incredibly wide range of practitioners, acousticians, social scientists, sound artists, urbanists, so many more. They all have a common interest, understanding, preserving and curating our acoustic environment. In 2014, the first Soundscape ISO standard was published, with the aim of enabling a broad international consensus around Soundscape's framework. Soundscape is defined here as the acoustic environment as perceived or experienced and/or understood by a person or people in context. Context is the key concept I would like to explore in the following slides. I'd like to quickly introduce Apex Acoustics first. We're a firm of acoustic consultants established by Jack Harvey Clark in 2006. We've grown to be one of the biggest acoustic firms in the region and we work nationwide. We're interested in soundscape as a communication tool to improve design outcomes. When I joined in 2019, my background in film theory helped us develop our building soundscape evaluation method, APEAL. APEAL is a film-based method that we use to portray building soundscapes. I drew from the literary tradition of Claudio Gartman, who introduced the concept of mutual implication of images and sound. We experience the acoustic environment in the same way, with both our eyes and our ears. The use of film allows us to communicate acoustics more broadly. Not everyone is familiar with acoustic lexicon, which is mostly mathematical. However, almost everyone is able to understand a scene in a film. A gym that is reverberant is chaotic, but a cathedral that isn't feels godless. A formula can't express context in the way that film can. After shooting a couple of clips on our phone, we soon realized that we wanted to create more traditionally cinematic content. This is when we decided to use point-of-view cameras and binaural microphones. Their combination results in films that are highly immersive and realistic. We recently started experimenting with 360 video and ambisonic audio. But this type of research is at its very early stages, and this is why we were very keen to collaborate with academia. This project was the perfect opportunity to do just that. As the 3D models are brought to life, visitors will be able to virtually experience Anglo-Saxon soundscapes in the most innovative way. And from an appeal point of view, a 3D model fulfills our need to portray, both orally and visually, the acoustic environment as accurately as possible. In other words, we are providing the listeners with a new level of contextualization and control.
For the first time, a new extremely accurate survey of Thirlings Building A at Jarrow Hall has led to the design of reliable digital models accurately reproducing the room acoustics and geometry of the experimental structure. The analysis reveals that, in terms of soundscape, the space inside the building is particularly uniform and dry. The speech intelligibility is the same in the entire structure, there are no identified privileged points, and reverberation is very low at all audible frequencies. Even when other materials are tested, for example adding a hypothetical wooden floor, the reverberation inside the room remains low. This is especially due to the current retouched roof, which is significantly sound absorbent, as confirmed by the ODEON auditorium genetic algorithm that calibrates the sound absorption coefficients on the basis of the values measured on site. Even with a different roof, the geometry of the building suggests the absence of any acoustic focal points. The first 3D digital models of the Yeavering Grandstand suggest a completely different situation. In this building, sound was differentiated and certainly played an important role. It is even possible that acoustics were deliberately designed during the construction. However, this is noticeable in the digital models based on the data from the archaeological excavations and not on the experimental structure reconstructed at Jarrow Hall. Apart from the geometrical outline and the suspended wooden elevation, which certainly improved the resonance of the space, the structure excavated at Yeavering was characterized by a different focal point than the one that nowadays is in Jarrow Hall. Rather than a stage, the focal point in Yeavering was interpreted as a very small platform surrounded by wooden screens. If the hypothesis is correct, room acoustic simulations show that these screens reinforce the sound emitted from the focal point towards the audience. This focal point becomes the only area of the building to be significantly privileged in both visual and oral terms. Today, we have explored new possibilities to extract a wide range of data from archaeological experiments using a digital approach based on laser scanning, room acoustic simulations, and the APEAL method. This approach takes into full account even the hypotheses that were impossible to reconstruct in the experimental structures at Jarrow Hall. It is now possible to go back to the first-hand archaeological data and compare them to the new evidences obtained from the digital models based on the experiments. The different archaeoacoustics simulated in Building A and the Grandstand seem to find parallels in the archaeological record. The archaeologists who excavated the site reported and documented an extremely sophisticated and precise setting for the Grandstand and much more approximate alignments for Building A at Thirlings. These elements are now leading to closer investigations on the character of the two sites in their wider historical context and on the role the sound could have played in the constructions of communitarian narratives.
Other buildings are now in the process of being digitally recorded, both for archival purposes and to inform the design and construction of new buildings, such as in the case of our Grubenhaus, which was vandalized during the first lockdown and will be now completely reconstructed. The results shared in this presentation will also inform the restoration of our own version of the Yeavering Grandstand, which currently includes some historically inappropriate structures. What's presented today is only part of a wider digital project which regards not only the experimental buildings of Jarrow, but also the Bede Museum, which contains our archaeological collection of the monastic site of Jarrow. Further studies will aim to the creation of a digital interpretative reconstruction of the different chronological phases of St. Paul's Church and the Jarrow Monastery, allowing to develop a virtual tour of these monuments. What we presented here is a work in progress. Therefore, any feedback and suggestions would be greatly valued and appreciated. Thank you.